Okay, in this video I'm going to be doing a quick demonstration on some descriptive geometry, specifically how to set up your coordinate axes and figure out the true length of a line graphically. So I've gone to the liberty of already drawing a square box and my axes here. I haven't labeled them yet. The scale of this drawing that I'm going to be using is 0.2 inches equals 1 unit. That corresponds to 1 inch equals 5 units, so that would be on my 50 scale. This is a good scale to use for engineering paper because these grids are actually 0.2 inches each, so if you're drawing a horizontal or vertical line, you don't need to use your scale. You can just count in grids if it's something close. Okay, so just to get ourselves oriented here with our coordinate axes, I've drawn up, this is just a cube of some sort with our faces labeled how our multi-view drawing would normally be oriented. So this is sort of the way that our axes would be set up, with Z pointing directly upwards, X down here, and Y pointing off to the right. That's how you'll see it in math when you're graphing in 3D most of the time. This corresponds to our right-hand rule. Okay, so for our multi-view drawing, we're normally drawing the face down here. And with our face, we're looking down this way at it. So we're looking down towards the XY plane here. So for these axes, I'm going to label Y and X. And then I'm also going to label the axis that's coming out of the page at me, which is the Z axis here. So I'll label that at the origin. If we were to rotate this box up, which I have done so here, I drew it in a different orientation where I basically took this back edge and I knocked it over this way so that this top face came up here to the top. So now I've got my top here and my profile on the side. So if I'm drawing the top view, then again I'm looking downward at it. So I'm looking in the XZ plane. So for the top, to keep our orientation the same, we would have the same distances in X. So this is going to be my X axis. And then now I've got this new axis that, if we think about revolving our coordinate axis, so as it comes up this way, I'm lifting this Y axis up off the page, and Z is going to be rotated down into the page. So here is my Z axis. And now Y is pointing directly up out of the page at me. So over here, our profile axes, if we're looking at it, this time if I'm looking at it this direction, at this profile face, I'm looking at the YZ plane. And again, this makes sense that I want to put Y here so that our Y distances are the same, so I have the same Y axis. And then Z would be coming out of the page this time. You can think about I would be rotating my x-axis up. So now X is going to be coming out of the page, and I've got Z here. One trick to doing this, if you have coordinates for points that you want to plot, you can go ahead and just plot them with your scale. Or if you are missing plots, you can actually use a miter line to find where your point of the line would show up in a different view. However, with descriptive geometry, your miter line actually has to be at a 45, so which means that your axes have to be set up square. So I went ahead and drew this ahead of time. We can see with my 50 scale, I've got a box that, I'll try and keep it in the screen. I've got a box that's 20 wide and 20 tall as well. Let's see if that's in focus there. There we go, that's a little better. Okay, so my miter line's at a 45, which means I can project things out of one view into the other. So I'll go ahead and plot two points just with the coordinates, and then I'll project for the third one. So I'm going from point A to point B here. Point A I've chosen to be 1, 1, 1, and point B is going to be 6, 8, 4. So like I said, the scale lines up with the grid on my engineering paper. So to plot that first point, I'll start down here. Plot point A is 1 over in x and 1 up in y. So there's my point A. For point B, I'm going to come over 6 grids. There's 1, 2, 3, 6. There's grid number 6, and I'm going to go up 8. So there's my point B. We can see I can check this with my scale to make sure that I've got the correct distances. There's 8. And then this way I'm coming over 6. So that's correct. So I will draw my line for the front view. And I'll go ahead and label. I've got point A down here. And I've got point B over here. I'm trying not to label them above or to the directly to the side of these points because I'm going to be projecting lines over. So for drawing my, I'll do the profile next. I know that just like with our multi-view drawings before, things need to line up correctly. So what I can do is just take my line here. I'm going to project over this way. Again, I'll do the same thing for point A. So A in X and, well, this time I'm looking at Y and Z. X is directly upwards. So again, the coordinates are going to be 1 over in the Z direction and 1 up in Y. So it's going to land right here on this line. So there's my point A again. And then B, I'm going up. Oops, off the page again. I'm going in Y, I'm going up 8, which means it'll line up with this line that I drew over in 8. And I'm going 4 over to the left, or in the Z direction. So I'll come over 1, 2, 3. I'm off the page a lot. 1, 2, 3, 4. There's 4 over and 8 up line lands on this line here. So there's point B. Again, I'll go ahead and connect that up. Okay, so for the top, I'll use the miter line to figure out where my points are going to land rather than just plotting coordinates. And I'll go ahead and check that with coordinates afterwards. So first, I'll do the same thing. I'll project up this way. So I know that point A needs to land on this line that I'm drawing up right now, and point B needs to land on this line. So since my miter line's at a 45, I can go ahead and just draw up this way from point B. A, I'll draw it this way. So then I can just go ahead and bring the line over from the miter line. I can sort of reflect about the miter line. Just going to land me here. Oops, need to come all the way over to the line for A. So there we go. There's where point A is going to land, and point B lands here. So I will draw that line in. Again, this is point B, and point A is up here. So I'll check the coordinates on that. So I'm looking down at the XZ plane here. So point A should be 1 and 1 on the XZ plane, which we can see it's 1 over and 1 down, or in the positive direction for Z, it's 1 this way. So that works out. B, I'm looking, again, XZ. So I'm concerned with 6 and 4. So it should be 6 over in the X direction. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Great, that worked out for 6. And then it should be down 1. 2, 3, 4 in the Z direction, which it is. So my coordinates worked out on these points. If I didn't say this before, this is an oblique line, meaning that the true length of the line isn't, it's not going to show up in any of these planes. If I have a, horizontal line, I'll have some sort of angle or a line or something where it's not true length in one of the other axes. Sorry, one of the other planes, like my front plane or my profile plane, but the horizontal line would show up true length in the top here, in the overhead view. Same thing with a frontal line, it would only show up true length here. With an oblique line, I don't have true length in any of these views. So I'm going to go ahead and figure out what that true length is graphically. So I could choose to do the true length method on any of these three planes. I'm going to go ahead and do the... I'll do the XY plane. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to project some reference lines off here. So I'll make sure that they are perpendicular to my line that I'm projecting off of. So these are just my perpendicular projection lines. I can make sure that these two are parallel with my triangles here. If you haven't seen this trick, this is a good one. If you use the triangles, line up one triangle so that it's parallel and use the other one to sort of slide along. So I can just slide this direction until I get to that other point and then draw my line. So now I know that these two lines are parallel to one another. So I'm going to step over just a little bit on that line and draw a reference line parallel to my original line AB in the front plane. So I will go ahead and draw a reference line here. I'm just going to label this reference. Okay, so I've got my reference line and I'm ready to start plotting. So in this plane, the dimensions of line A and B are my X and Y dimensions. So I'm missing the Z dimension here. You can think about this as we're looking down at this line, and we know that this line actually starts out 1 off the Z-axis and rises to 4 at point B. So it's actually rising up here. So I'd be getting higher off the page, closer to the lens here, for point B. So this line AB that I've drawn is sort of a shadow cast by that line from directly overhead. So I need to add in that Z distance to get the true length of my line. So what I can do is, from my reference line, I can either, I think the method Karen did in class was, I know A is 1 off the Z axis, 1 in the Z direction rather, and B is 4 in the Z direction, so I could come over point A, I could come over 1 from the reference line and 4 from B to get that Z direction. Or since I know that the difference between the two is 3, I can actually just put a point here on, I can land the point on the reference line. So then all I need to do is I'll take my 50 scale and I'll say, okay, I'm going over 1, 2, 3. So I've come 3 over from where the reference line was. So now I've got my X and Y distances from before, and I've added in that Z, the change in Z, which is 3. So I will go ahead and draw that line in, and this line is my true length. So now I've accounted for all of the distances. So there's true length. So I will check this with my scale to see what I think the true length is. So it looks like, okay, I'm right about 9, maybe slightly over 9. So that's just my scale. It looks like it's about 9 units long. So I'll say true length is approximately 9 units. Okay, to check this, I can actually do a mathematical check. So I'll, for those of you that haven't seen vectors before, you're going to be using them in 4A, 5C, statics, pretty much everywhere. I'm just going to take my final point minus my initial point. So I would have my vector, I'll call it R for my position vector. I'm going from 1 in X to 6, so it's 5, the change in X is 5. The change in Y is going from 1 to 8, so that's 7. And it's going from 1 to 4 in Z, so my R vector is 5, 7, 3. To check the magnitude of this line, or the actual length of it, I can find the hypotenuse, or it's kind of like a distance formula, so the hypotenuse is going to be equal to the X coordinate of my R vector squared plus the Y coordinate squared plus Z squared, and all of that is going to be quantity square root. So if I plug this into my calculator, I'm going to have 5 squared plus 7 squared plus 3 squared. That all turns out to be true. I punched this into my calculator ahead of time. That ends up being actually 9.1 units. So we can see that I was thinking it was about 9, maybe a little bit over. And that's what it ended up being for my true length. So that means that our graphical method here works. Just one casual reminder, if you're using the miter line projection, you do need to have it be a square box with a 45 degree miter line. I had forgotten about that and ended up making some mistakes and was wondering why my miter line wasn't working. So if you're using a miter line to project these points, it needs to be at 45. So there you have it. There's how to set up your axes and define the true length of your line. If anyone wants to, I can actually set up this line in AutoCAD and rotate it around so you can sort of see visually what's happening, because I know it can be a little bit difficult to visualize what this line's doing on the paper since you can't see all three axes at the same time. So if you have any questions, I'll be around the STEM Center. Okay, so I quickly sketched up that line that I just drew for our true length problem. Used AutoCAD to do this. So here we go. I'm looking at my XY plane. This is our front face. We can see it's got a width of 5 and a height of 7. That comes from our point 1, 1 and our coordinate 6, 8. If I rotate myself around to look at one of these other views, like let's see if I can get in the right. Okay, so here's ZY plane, which is our profile view. It's got a height of 3 here, and the way I drew it on paper and the way you'll be drawing it, it's actually rotated around a bit so that our Z-axis is the horizontal one and Y is vertical. I'm having a hard time rotating around to get that to show up. You'd be looking at it, well, I guess you can't see me tilting my head in the video. Tilt your head 90 degrees to the right and it will show up just like how I've got it drawn in the previous part of the video. So the height would actually be 7 and the width 3. And then if we look at it from overhead, I guess I'm not going to be able to see it from overhead, but I can look at it from the bottom in the ZY plane. So again, it would be sort of mirrored. I'm looking at the bottom rather than the top. So here's our point 1, 1, and then in Z it's going over a distance of, or in X rather, it's going over a distance of 5 still, and then the height 3 in Z. But you can see in all of these views that we're looking at, it's actually foreshortened. When I'm rotated around sort of perpendicular to the line, it's actually the longest. And I can again use AutoCAD to check that distance. So if I say, use the distance command, this is a command you'll learn later in the class. I'll just click on the two endpoints, and I can see that the distance, went away. If I use the distance command, I can see that this is actually 9.1 units long. So that confirms my math check and my graphic check, that it's just slightly longer than 9 units. So there you have it. There's true length of a line, checked a few different ways. Again, I'll save a copy of this if you want to visualize a little better. You can, I can show you how to rotate this around in AutoCAD so you can see what's going on a little bit better.